Hello, my dear students. In this lecture, I will discuss about ectopic pregnancy, such as its definition, sites of implantation, etiology, modes of termination, clinical features, diagnosis, and its management. Before moving towards the topic, guys, I just first want to say that if you will find my video useful, then please like to my video and also give your valuable comments. That actually motivates me to make more videos for you guys. And those who are new at my channel, please subscribe to my channel for getting notifications. Now coming back towards the topic, that is ectopic pregnancy. Generally, the meaning of ectopic is an abnormal place or position. So when the fertilized ovum is implanted at some abnormal site or place, that is known as ectopic pregnancy. First, its definition. An ectopic pregnancy is one in which the fertilized ovum is implanted or attaches and develops outside the normal uterine cavity. Normally, the fertilized ovum is implanted superiorly inside the uterus. Superiorly means near the fundus and at the posterior wall of the uterus. But if the fertilized ovum is implanted or attaches at the site other than normal, either inside the uterine cavity or outside the uterine cavity, is known as ectopic pregnancy. Next are the sites of implantation. Under this, I will discuss the various sites where the fertilized ovum can implant. The implantation sites are separated into two types, that are extrauterine, in which the fertilized ovum is implanted outside the uterine cavity, and another one is uterine. In this case, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the uterine cavity but at abnormal place or at abnormal site. It occurs very rarely, that is in 1.5% cases. First, I will discuss extrauterine. Under extrauterine, the first type is tubal pregnancy. In this case, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes, and this is the common type of ectopic pregnancy. That is, in 97% cases, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. And again, under tubal pregnancy, there are four sites where the fertilized ovum can implant, as the fallopian tubes have different parts, as you can see in this diagram. This part is known as infundibulum, and here it is ampulla, and this part is isthmus, and the remaining one is interstitial. In general or in normal, the meaning of interstitial is the place or the point between the two parts. Here I draw a rough diagram. In the 18% cases, the fertilized ovum is implanted at the infundibulum inside the fallopian tubes. In the 55% cases, the fertilized ovum is implanted at ampulla inside the fallopian tubes. In 25% cases, the fertilized ovum is implanted at isthmus inside the fallopian tubes. While in 20% of cases, the fertilized ovum is implanted at an interstitial site. After the tubal pregnancy, next under the extrauterine pregnancy is ovarian pregnancy. In this, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the ovary. As you can see here in the diagram, this is the fertilized ovum and this is ovary. So the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the ovary. That's why it is known as ovarian pregnancy. And the third type under extrauterine pregnancy is abdominal pregnancy. In this case, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the abdominal cavity. And under abdominal pregnancy, again, there are two sites, that are primary and secondary abdominal pregnancy. In the case of primary abdominal pregnancy, the primary site or the first site of implantation of the fertilized ovum is abdominal cavity. While in the case of secondary abdominal pregnancy, the primary site or the first site of implantation of fertilized ovum is either uterus or fallopian tubes. Means, firstly, it is implanted either inside the uterus or inside the fallopian tubes, and then it comes out or escapes out and implanted inside the abdominal cavity. Means, the abdominal cavity is the second site or the secondary site of implantation of fertilized ovum. How it escapes out? As in the case of fallopian tubes, the fallopian tubes might ruptured and then the conceptus escapes out from the fallopian tubes and implanted inside the abdominal cavity. While in the case of uterus, if there is a scar in uterus, from that scar the conceptus may comes out and implanted inside the abdominal cavity. So abdominal cavity is a secondary site of implantation, that's why it is known as secondary abdominal pregnancy. Under secondary abdominal pregnancy, again there are two sites that are intraperitoneal and extraperitoneal broad ligaments. It is clear from its name, intraperitoneal means inside the abdominal cavity, while extraperitoneal means outside the abdominal cavity where broad ligaments are present. So if the conceptus is implanted at the roof or at the sides of the tube, if the, like here, this is considered as a roof of fallopian tubes or the sides of fallopian tubes, then it is known as intraperitoneal site of implantation. While if the conceptus is implanted at the floor of the tube, here where the broad ligaments is attached, this white portion is considered as a broad ligaments. Here the broad ligaments are present and this is the round ligament. Here you can see the conceptus is implanted at the extraperitoneal broad ligament site. After the extrauterine pregnancy, next under the implantation sites are intrauterine or uterine pregnancy. Under this, there are three sites where the fertilized ovum can implant it, that are cervical, angular and Cornwall. Firstly, I'll discuss Cornwall. Here I draw a rough diagram. Here you can see this line. This is a superolateral angle. For example, this is a fundus and from here the fallopian tubes are started. And from the middle of the opening of the fallopian tubes, this angle actually started. And this angle is known as superolateral angle, which is also known as cornua of the uterus. And if the fertilized ovum is implanted somewhere here, that is known as cornual pregnancy. And it is mostly occur in the case of bicornuate uterus or in the case of unicornuate uterus. Next is angular. In this diagram you can see this is the angular site. Here the fertilized ovum is implanted at the lateral side, and as the pregnancy advances, it causes the asymmetrical enlargement of the uterus, means the shape of the uterus is distorted or becomes abnormal, as well as it causes the displacement, that is the lateral displacement of the round ligament. As I told you, here the broad ligaments are present as well as the round ligament. This is the round ligament. And if the fertilized ovum is implanted at the angular site, it will cause the lateral displacement as the pregnancy advances. And the last one is cervical pregnancy. As you can see in this diagram, here the fertilized ovum is implanted at the cervix, so that's why it is known as cervical pregnancy. So this lecture will be more focused on the tubal pregnancy, as this is one of the most common type of ectopic pregnancy. Continuing with the first site of implantation or the common type of ectopic pregnancy, that is tubal pregnancy, when the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. Its etiology, why it is implanted inside the fallopian tubes, why not in the uterine cavity? So there are certain factors which are responsible for the fertilized ovum to remain inside the fallopian tubes. And what are they? The first one is, there are certain factors or causes which preventing or delaying the migration or transfer of the fertilized ovum to the uterine cavity. As the fertilization takes place inside the fallopian tubes, and then the fertilized ovum is migrated or transferred from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity where it is implanted normally. But if the migration or the transfer of fertilized ovum is delayed, it favors the implantation of fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. While on the other hand side, there are certain factors which facilitating or favors the nidation. Now what is nidation? It means the implantation. So there are certain factors which favors the implantation of the fertilized ovum in the fallopian tubes. So I will discuss all the factors under both the headings one by one. First one is the factors which are delaying the migrations. Under this, there is a pelvic inflammatory disease. It is actually the infection of the female reproductive organs. In this case, the bacteria spreads from the vagina to the uterus or fallopian tubes or ovaries. So due to the presence of PID, that is pelvic inflammatory disease, there is a loss of cilia. Now what is cilia? A hair-like structure is present inside the fallopian tubes which helps in the migration or transfer or movement of the fertilized ovum to the uterine cavity. But due to its absence, the migration is delayed. Plus, it causes narrowing of the lumen, means the space inside the cavity is decreased due to the presence of scar tissues. Now, what are scar tissues? These are the damaged tissues due to the presence of disease. As you can see here in the diagram, this is the healthy section of reproductive system. And here, the reproductive system is with PID, that is pelvic inflammatory disease. And here you can see the pus is present, which actually narrows the lumen of the fallopian tubes, because of which the fertilized ovum or egg does not make its way through fallopian tubes. So because of the lack of enough space, the fertilized ovum is unable to migrate from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity. As a result, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. The next factor which delays the migration of fertilized ovum into the uterine cavity is iatrogenic, means the tubal pregnancy occurs due to some medical procedure or treatment. Under this, first one is contraception failure. Normally the contraceptives are used to prevent the pregnancy, but while using contraceptives, if the pregnancy occurs due to its failure, then the pregnancy will be ectopic one. So first one is intrauterine devices, which prevents the intrauterine pregnancy. It actually prevents the sperm from reaching to the fallopian tubes. But somehow, due to the contraceptive failure, if the sperm reaches at the fallopian tubes and fertilizes the ovum, then the intrauterine devices prevent the implantation of the fertilized ovum into the uterus. That's why the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. Next is sterilization operations, which are usually performed to prevent the pregnancy permanently. In this case, either the fallopian tubes are blocked or separated. But then how pregnancy occurs? Then how the ovum is fertilized? Through fistula. What is fistula? It is believed that an abnormal connection between the two parts is formed. Between the two parts of fallopian tubes are formed, and that is small, but a sperm can easily pass through it in order to fertilize the ovum. But it is too small that a fertilized ovum is not able to migrate into the uterine cavity. That's why that fertilized ovum is implanted inside the distal end. What is the meaning of distal end? That is away from center. This is the proximal end, and from here, if the tube is separated, or if here the fistula is situated, then this one is the distal end of the fallopian tubes, and here the fertilized ovum is implanted. Especially in the case of laparoscopic fulguration without tubal resection, this is an operation in which, through the help of laparoscope, the fulguration is performed. What is fulguration? That is destroying the tissues of fallopian tubes with the use of heat from the electric current without tubal resection. Means the tubes are not separated in this case, only the tissues are destroyed. And in this case, there are the chances of ectopic pregnancy. Next is use of progestin-only pill or the post-coital estrogen preparation. So after the intercourse, the post-coital estrogen preparations or the progestin-only pills are administered. But till then, if the fertilization of ovum occurs, and this drug impairs the tubal mobility, because of which that fertilized ovum is unable to migrate into the uterine cavity, As a result, tubal pregnancy occurs. Under iatrogenic factor, next is tubal reconstructive surgeries, which are performed to treat the infertility. As the sterilization operations are performed in order to prevent the pregnancy permanently by separating the fallopian tubes. But in future, if the parent want to conceive a child, then tubal reconstructive surgeries are performed, such as the tubal anastomosis is done. Nowadays, anastomosis, that is, a connection is made between the separated fallopian tubes in order to conceive a child. But these reconstructive surgeries causes structural abnormalities sometimes, such as impaired tubal mobility, kinking of the fallopian tube, that is twisting of the fallopian tube, and terminal stricture, that is the narrowing of the lumen of the fallopian tubes, and because of which the fertilized ovum is unable to migrate from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity. As a result, tubal pregnancy occurs. Next, under the iatrogenic factors is intrapelvic adhesions after pelvic surgery. So after the pelvic surgery, there are the chances of injury to the tissues, and because of that injury, the adhesions will form. Now, what are those adhesions? These are basically the scar tissues which stick the organs with each other. For example, these are two organs, and a scar tissue is formed between these two organs, which are normally not like this. And these scar tissues are formed due to the injury to the tissues as a result of pelvic surgery. And what actually these scar tissues are doing here, they stick the two organs with each other. And if the tube or the ovary stick to other organs or to the side of the pelvis, as a result, the fertilized ovum is unable to migrate from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity. As a result, tubal pregnancy may occur. Another one under the iatrogenic factors is artificial reproductive techniques. There are various artificial reproductive techniques which helps to conceive the baby, but sometimes it may cause ectopic pregnancy. Now how? First one is ovulation induction. So there are certain drugs which are used to induce the ovulation. What is ovulation? That is releasing of egg from the ovary to the fallopian tubes. Especially the clomiphene citrate, this is a drug which no doubt induces the ovulation, but side by side it may also cause fallopian tube abnormalities. So there are estrogen receptors which are present inside the fallopian tubes, which enhances the tubal mobility so that fertilized ovum can migrate from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity. But this clomiphene citrate drug act as a estrogen receptor antagonist. It blocks the estrogen receptors. As a result, tubal mobility will decreases, and which causes tubal pregnancy. The another artificial reproductive technique is in vitro fertilization embryo transfer. In this case, the ovum and the sperm is fertilized in the laboratory, and then that fertilized ovum is transferred into the uterine cavity. And it is believed that the fresh embryo transfer causes the ectopic pregnancy in the 71% cases, while in the case of frozen embryo transfer, the chances of ectopic pregnancy is less, that is in only 11% cases. So the another technique is GIFT, that is gamete intrafallopian transfer. In this case, the ovum and the sperm is transferred inside the fallopian tubes so that the fertilization occurs. But there may be the possibility the fallopian tubes are already blocked or the tubal mobility is impaired, and that's why this fertilized ovum is unable to migrate from the fallopian tubes to the uterine cavity. As a result, tubal pregnancy may occur. Next are others. So if there is a previous history of ectopic pregnancy, then there are the chances that ectopic pregnancy may occur in the current pregnancy. So under others, next one is prior induced abortion. Due to the pregnancy, if there is a risk to the health of the mother, then abortion is induced, and it may cause post-abortal infection. And because of infection, as I already discussed in the pelvic inflammatory disease, that there are the chances of loss of cilia or narrowing of the lumen of the fallopian tubes. As a result, tubal pregnancy may occur. Next are the developmental defects of the tube. Or we can also say the congenital anomalies of the fallopian tubes. Under this, first one is elongation. If the fallopian tubes are much longer than the normal, then there are the chances of implantation of fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Next one is diverticulum. Now, what are diverticulum? These are small, thin-walled outpouchings or the pocket-like structures are present in the isthmic or ampullary portion of the fallopian tubes, like this. These are the diverticulums which may be present inside the fallopian tubes, which might cause tubal pregnancy, as the fertilized ovum is unable to pass through the fallopian tubes. Next is accessory ostia. What is ostia? That is opening. If there is another or extra opening is present inside the fallopian tubes, that might also cause ectopic pregnancy. As there are only two openings present in the fallopian tubes, that is here the tubal ostia and here there is abdominal ostia. And apart from these two openings, if there is any accessory or extra opening present inside the fallopian tubes, that might cause ectopic pregnancy. Another cause is transperitoneal migration of the ovum. What is the meaning of transperitoneal? Means through the abdominal cavity, if ovum is migrated, that might also cause tubal pregnancy. Now how? This is the ovary. So ovary releases ovum, which is normally enters into the fallopian tubes through abdominal ostia. But instead of entering into the fallopian tubes, if the ovum is migrated through the abdominal cavity like this and enters into the another fallopian tubes through the abdominal ostia, and that migration might also causes the implantation of the fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Next are the factors which facilitating or favors the nidation or the implantation of fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Now what are those factors? As the fertilized ovum is having the outer layer which is known as zona pellucida, and after the zona pellucida there is a layer of trophoblast cells which helps in the implantation or the attachment of fertilized ovum with the decidua. So this zona pellucida will breaks down within 4 to 5 days after fertilization, and then the trophoblast cells starts its activity of implantation with the decidua. But if this zona pellucida breaks down earlier, that is before the 4 to 5 days, when the fertilized ovum is still inside the fallopian tubes, and after the breakdown this trophoblast cells starts its activity earlier, as a result this fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. As here it is written, early beginning or the resumption of the trophoblast activity due to the premature degeneration or the breakdown of the zona pellucida causes the implantation of the fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Another factor is increased decidual reaction. The innermost layer of the uterus is known as decidua. And what is decidual reaction? It is the thickness of the decidua during the pregnancy. And if the thickness of the decidua is more than normal, that favors the implantation of fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Next is tubal endometriosis. Normally, the tissues which are grow inside the uterus, if grown into the fallopian tubes, that is known as tubal endometriosis, which favors the implantation of fertilized ovum inside the fallopian tubes. Next is the mode of termination of tubal pregnancy, that how the tubal pregnancy is terminated or ended. So because of the unfavorable environment inside the fallopian tubes for the fertilized ovum, early discontinuation or the interruption of pregnancy is inevitable. Inevitable means sure to happen or occur within 6 to 8 weeks. But if the implantation occurs in ampulla, that is the part of fallopian tubes where the fertilization takes place, and the lumen at this part is much larger, that's why the pregnancy continues little longer than 6 to 8 weeks. On the other hand side, if in interstitial implantation, the pregnancy may continue up to 3 to 4 months. How this much longer the pregnancy will continue? Because at interstitial space, the myometrial tissues are present, because of which there is a high vascularity, means there is a huge blood supply to the embryo or the fetus. That's why the pregnancy continues up to 3 to 4 months. Next are the modes of termination. Basically, there are 4 modes of termination, that are tubal mole, tubal abortion, tubal rupture and tubal perforation. So I will discuss all these one by one in detail. So first one is tubal mole. In this case, firstly, the embryo is converted into tubal mole. Now, what is tubal mole? In which the gestational sac is surrounded by a blood. Here you can see in this diagram, in the blue color, this is amniotic cavity. In the orange color, this is chorionic cavity. And collectively, it is known as gestational sac, and around which the blood is accumulated. That's why it is known as tubal mole. So because of the repeated small hemorrhages in the choriocapsular space, which is choriocapsular space, that is a space between the chorion and the decidua capsularis. Here you can see in the red color, this is a choriocapsular space. So because of the repeated hemorrhages at this place, the chorionic villi are separated from its attachment. So this separated tubal mole has two possibilities. First one is complete absorption. Either this tubal mole is completely absorbed inside the fallopian tubes or aborted. So second one is tubal abortion. What is tubal abortion? When this tubal mole is expelled out from the fallopian tubes through the abdominal ostia. So the opening of the fallopian tubes at this point is known as abdominal ostia. And this expelled content then collected here in the pouch of Douglas. Now what is pouch of Douglas, or where it is situated? It is a pocket-like structure which is situated between the rectum and the uterus. So when the blood is collected, which causes swelling in the pelvic area, that is known as pelvic hematocele. So that's why the complete tubal abortion causes pelvic hematocele. The next mode of termination of tubal pregnancy is tubal abortion. The complete tubal abortion I already discussed, which causes pelvic hematocele. And the second possibility in the case of tubal abortion is incomplete tubal abortion. In this case, the space where the embryo was attached actually not retracted. What is the meaning of retracted? That is the shortening of the muscles. Here, where the embryo was situated, the next mode of termination of tubal pregnancy is tubal abortion, which has two possibilities, that is the complete tubal abortion and the incomplete tubal abortion. The complete tubal abortion I already discussed, which leads to pelvic hematocele. And the another one is incomplete tubal abortion. In this case, the space inside the fallopian tubes where the embryo was attached is not retracted. What is the meaning of retracted? Means the tissues are not permanently shortened. As a result, the tiny blood vessels or the sinuses remain open. As a result, the bleeding occurs, which is known as diffuse intraperitoneal hemorrhage. Diffuse means it spreads in the peritoneal cavity, that is the abdominal cavity. So when there is a presence of free blood inside the peritoneal cavity, that is known as diffuse intraperitoneal hemorrhage. The another mode of termination of tubal pregnancy is tubal rupture. Tubal rupture occurs mostly in those cases in which the fertilized ovum is either implanted at isthmus or at interstitial part of the fallopian tube. Now, why the tubal rupture occurs at both these parts of the fallopian tubes? Because the lumen at isthmus and at interstitial part of the fallopian tubes is narrow or short, plus the walls are less stretchable. That's why the chorionic villi can easily destroy the wall of the fallopian tubes. As a result, tear will occur, and from that tear the fetus will escapes out without the gestational sac. In this, the amnion is ruptured, plus the fetus is dead and a huge amount of bleeding occurs. So above the fallopian tubes, that is known as the roof of the fallopian tubes, which is also known as intraperitoneal, as this roof of fallopian tubes comes under the abdominal cavity. And if the tear is present at the roof of the fallopian tubes, then it will causes diffuse intraperitoneal hemorrhage, as a huge amount of bleeding occurs at the roof of the fallopian tubes. So that's why it is collectively known as diffuse intraperitoneal hemorrhage. While on the contrary, or on the opposite side, if the fallopian tubes ruptured at the floor, if there is a tear present at the floor of the fallopian tubes, then it will causes intraligamentary hematoma. Now, what is hematoma? It is the abnormal collection of the blood outside the blood vessels. So, if the tear is present at the floor of the fallopian tubes, then the bleeding occurs at the floor of the fallopian tubes. As a result, the hematoma or the abnormal blood collection occurs between the ligaments. That's why it is known as intraligamentary hematoma. After the tubal rupture, next mode of termination of tubal pregnancy is tubal perforation. These both terms may appear to be the same, but there is a difference between both of them that I will discuss. So, tubal perforation, the meaning of perforation is a hole. The process of perforation of fallopian tubes is actually slow. In this, gestational sac is present. The amnion is remain intact. In this case, the amnion is not ruptured. So, as you can see in this diagram, if there is a hole at the roof of the fallopian tubes, then from that hole, the fetus escapes out along with the amniotic sac. Plus, in this case, the fetus is living. So, the fetus is then implanted in the abdominal cavity. That's why it is known as secondary abdominal pregnancy, because its primary site of implantation is fallopian tubes. And if the hole is present at the floor of the fallopian tubes, then the fetus will comes here at the floor of the fallopian tubes. And as the ligaments are present here, that is the broad ligaments, that's why it is known as secondary intraligamentary pregnancy. So I hope you all are clear with the difference. In this case, in the tubal rupture, the fetus is dead plus amnion is ruptured. While in this case, the fetus is not dead, the fetus is actually living, plus the amnion is intact in this case. And last one, there is another possibility in the case of tubal pregnancy that pregnancy may continue, but it is very, very rarest. Next are the clinical features of tubal pregnancy that I will discuss under three headings, that are acute, unruptured tubal pregnancy, and third one is chronic. So first one, acute. What is the meaning of acute? When the symptoms are severe plus its onset is sudden. So acute symptoms occur in 30% of cases, so it is basically less common. The acute symptoms mostly occurs when the fallopian tubes are ruptured. The classic triad of symptoms are, what is the meaning of classic triad? Triad is a group of three symptoms. And what is the meaning of classic? That is the usual or the most common symptoms of tubal pregnancy. First one is amenorrhea, that is the absence of menstrual cycle, basically for 6 to 8 weeks. As I already told you that after 6 to 8 weeks, the tubal pregnancy is terminated. After which, the abdominal pain occurs. Now, why the abdominal pain occurs? Because of the distension of tubes. As the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes, so as the pregnancy continues, the fallopian tubes is distended. As a result, abdominal pain occurs. Now, what is the nature of abdominal pain? It is severe and sharp in nature. Plus, the pain initially occurs only at the lower abdomen, but slowly it spreads all over the abdomen. And lastly, vaginal bleeding. As the tubal pregnancy is terminated after 6 to 8 weeks, then the HCG level is also drops. That is, human chorionic gonadotropin hormone is decreases as the tubal pregnancy is terminated. And as a result, the decidua breakdown occurs in the uterine cavity. As the decidua is prepared, or decidua is an inner layer which is prepared for the pregnancy, but the pregnancy is continuing inside the fallopian tubes. But when it is terminated from the fallopian tubes, then the HCG level is dropped, and as a result, the decidua breaks, which causes vaginal bleeding. When the fallopian tubes are ruptured, the bleeding occurs either intraperitoneal or extraperitoneal, but not vaginal. So vaginal bleeding only occurs due to the breakdown of the decidua. Once the fallopian tubes rupture, the patient might feel nausea, vomiting, fainting attacks, even to the extent of syncope may be present. Now, what is syncope? That is the temporary loss of the consciousness, and these symptoms occurs due to the sudden fall in the blood pressure. Now, how the blood pressure falls? The first reason behind it is the huge loss of blood due to the rupturing of the fallopian tubes. And when the huge blood loss occurs, it decreases the blood pressure. And the second reason behind it, as when the fallopian tube rupture, hemorrhage occurs, such as the intraperitoneal hemorrhage, and that blood actually causes the irritation of the peritoneum, or we can say the peritonitis, that is the inflammation of the peritoneum or the infection of the peritoneum. So due to the infection of the peritoneum, toxins or the infectious substances enters the blood circulation, and when the toxins enters the blood circulation, vasomotor collapse occur. What is the meaning of vasomotor collapse? That is the failure of the circulation, and when the failure of circulation occurs, the BP will fall. As a result, these symptoms occurs. So when the fallopian tubes rupture, during general examination, it is revealed that patient lies quite conscious and the patient may have sweating and looks blanched. What is the meaning of blanched? Means pale. Now why the patient looks paler? Due to the huge loss of blood. And due to the huge loss of blood, the features of shock may be present, such as rapid and feeble or weak pulse, fall in BP, cold and kami extremities. Kami means wetty extremities. The features of shock are present due to the decreased circulating blood volume. So during abdominal examination, it is revealed that abdomen is tense, means stretched, and tender. Now what is the meaning of tender? It means when the affected area is touched, pain occurs. And during bimanual examination, that is the examination which is done by using both the hands, it is revealed that uterus floats as if in the water. Why the uterus floats? Because of the presence of blood inside the uterine cavity. Next is uterus is slightly bulky or large. Another heading under the clinical features of tubal pregnancy is unruptured tubal ectopic. So in the case of tubal pregnancy, when the fallopian tubes are not ruptured yet, till then what kind of symptoms are present in the patient? So first of all, the unruptured tubal pregnancy is diagnosed by chance or accidentally during laparoscopy. What is the meaning of laparoscopy? That is the examination of abdominal organs with the help of laparoscope. So the symptoms which are present: delayed period or amenorrhea, or spotting with features suggestive of pregnancy. So amenorrhea or spotting occurs which suggests the pregnancy. So why the spotting occurs? Spotting mainly occurs during the early pregnancy. It is a light vaginal bleeding which occurs due to the implantation. As while implantation, the fertilized ovum digs a deep hole normally inside the uterine cavity, but in this case inside the fallopian tubes. So when the fertilized ovum digs a deep hole in order to implant, the light vaginal bleeding occurs. Uneasiness on one side of the flank. So on the side where the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes, on that side the patient may feel uneasiness or sometimes colicky or the sharp pain on that side. Next are the signs. While doing bimanual examination, it is revealed that uterus is smaller than the period of amenorrhea. Now why? Because instead of implantation inside the uterine cavity, the fertilized ovum is implanted inside the fallopian tubes. So while doing the vaginal examination, it is revealed that a pulsatile, what is the meaning of pulsatile? Means the pulsation is felt, which suggests the live fetus. So pulsatile, small, well circumscribed. What is the meaning of well circumscribed? It means the boundaries are clearly defined. Tender mass is felt through one fornix separated from the uterus. Now what is the fornix? This is the cervix and this is the vagina. And this portion, this part is known as fornices. One of both is anterior or another one is posterior fornix. So through one fornix, it is revealed that a pulsatile, small, well circumscribed tender mass is felt. Under the clinical features, next is chronic ectopic. What is the meaning of chronic symptoms? Means the symptoms which are present for the long time plus the onset of the symptoms is insidious or slow. Means the symptoms slowly develop. So the patient with tubal pregnancy may have the attacks of severe pain, but with time it recovers. Or the patient may have the chronic features or the slowly developing symptoms from the beginning. So the chronic symptoms mostly occur in the case of tubal abortion, when the tubal pregnancy is resolved by its own with the expulsion of fertilized ovum from the fallopian tubes. So the usual or the common symptoms which are present during the tubal pregnancy is pain in the lower abdomen, amenorrhea and vaginal bleeding. The other symptoms include bladder irritation, rectal tenesmus, increase in temperature. So during the tubal abortion, the pelvic hematocele is formed. What is the hematocele? That is the accumulation of blood which actually causes the swelling. So where the accumulation of blood takes place? It takes place at the pouch of Douglas. So it puts the pressure on the other organs, such as on the rectum, which as a result causes rectal tenesmus. So what is rectal tenesmus? When the patient feels that she is unable to pass stool, but actually there is nothing left to expel. Or if this hematocele become infected, it causes rise in temperature. Or this pelvic hematocele also causes bladder irritation, means the cystitis, that is the inflammation or the infection of bladder, which as a result causes the symptoms either retention of urine or increase the frequency of urination. So on examination it is revealed that the features of shock are absent as the onset of the symptoms is actually slow. And with bimanual examination it is revealed that an ill-defined boggy means a soft or tender mass is felt at the pouch of Douglas. Now how it is revealed? With the vaginal examination. So through the posterior fornix, as the posterior fornix is present near the pouch of Douglas, so by examining the fornices it is revealed that an ill-defined boggy tender mass is present at the pouch of Douglas. Next is tenderness on the lower abdomen on the affected side. Mass in the lower abdomen is felt, which is irregular and tender, which I already explained. So there is another thing which is present, which is very, very important. That is the Kulin's sign. What is this sign actually? The dark bluish discoloration occurs around the umbilicus, which suggests the intraperitoneal hemorrhage. So when around the umbilicus the dark bluish discoloration occurs, that is known as Kulin's sign, which suggests the intraperitoneal hemorrhage. Next are the investigations which I usually perform for diagnosing the tubal pregnancy. Under this, first one is blood examination. HP level should be assessed as the huge blood loss occurs due to the rupture of the fallopian tubes. ABO-RH grouping should be done as in case the blood transfusion is required. TLC, DLC plus ESR should be assessed as there are the chances of infection. ESR is increased due to the leukocytosis. What is leukocytosis? That is increase in the number of WBC cells due to the presence of infection. Next is cultosynthesis. It is the procedure in which the blood is removed from the pouch of Douglas with the help of 18 gauge lumbar puncture needle, and the needle is inserted through the posterior fornix, which is actually near to pouch of Douglas. Next is estimation of HCG, that is human chorionic gonadotropin hormone. Its presence reveals the pregnancy but not the location of the pregnancy. So that's why sonography should be performed, specifically transvaginal sonography. So if the HCG is present but the intrauterine pregnancy is absent, that is the intrauterine cavity is empty, which is revealed by the sonography, it means there is an ectopic pregnancy. Plus with the help of sonography, the fluid or the blood accumulated in the pouch of Douglas is revealed. Next is the combination of quantitative HCG value and sonography. So these both tests should be performed together, in which HCG amount is revealed, which is more than 1500 international units per liter. And if the sonography reveals the empty uterine cavity, it means there is ectopic pregnancy. And if the HCG is not double within 48 hours, then it is also revealed that there is ectopic pregnancy. Next is laparoscopy, that is the examination of the abdominal organs with the help of the laparoscope. It actually helps to confirm the diagnosis. Plus, when the diagnosis is confirmed side by side, it helps in the removal of ectopic mass using the operative procedure at the same time. Next is dilatation and curettage, that is the dilatation of the cervix and curettage, in which the uterine contents is removed, which reveals that decidua is without villi structure. It means that the fertilized ovum does not implant it inside the uterine cavity. Next is serum progesterone level. If the serum progesterone level is more than 25 nanogram per milliliter, it means there is intrauterine pregnancy. But if the serum progesterone level is less than 5 nanogram per milliliter, it means there is a ectopic pregnancy. Next is laparotomy. It is the procedure when an incision is made on the abdomen. So when there is a doubt or when there is a difficulty in diagnosing the tubal pregnancy, then the approach which is used for diagnosing the tubal pregnancy is open and see. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, means if there is a failure of perfusion of tissues properly, then, or we can see when the features of shock are present, then the laparotomy should be used in order to diagnose the condition, as it helps to prevent the mistaking in diagnosis which might lead to death of the patient. So that's why this is a very quick method in order to diagnose and treat the tubal pregnancy in the case of hemodynamically unstable patients. Next is scheme management of tubal ectopic pregnancy. Under this, first of all, the detailed history should be taken, evaluation of the high risk factors, and general examination of the patient should be done. The general examination, which mostly reveals that whether the patient is paler or not. Urine sample should be collected in order to assess the presence of human chorionic gonadotropin hormone. Ultrasound scan should be done specifically. Transvaginal should be preferred. And if there are strong clinical features of tubal pregnancy is present, plus the human chorionic gonadotropin hormone is present, which reveals that there is a pregnancy, but the patient is in shock or the vital organs of the patient are not having the proper blood supply, that is, the patient is hemodynamically unstable, then resuscitate the patient, start the IV infusion, and laparotomy should be performed. Laparotomy, in which the incision on the abdomen should be made in order to quickly handle the condition or in order to quickly diagnose the condition. So if the fallopian tubes are already ruptured, then salpingectomy should be done, that is the complete removal of the fallopian tube. But if some clinical features are present but the human chorionic gonadotropin is absent, then repeat human chorionic gonadotropin assessment in 1 week, and if it is negative, means there is no any ectopic pregnancy. But if some clinical features are present and human chorionic gonadotropin hormone is also present, it means the patient is pregnant, then transvaginal ultrasound or transvaginal sonography should be performed, which reveals intrauterine sac, means gestational sac is present inside the uterine cavity. It means that fertilized ovum is implanted normally inside the uterine cavity. So to determine the viability, that whether the conceptus is live or able to grow or not, so human chorionic gonadotropin level, if increases more than 60% or if it is double within 48 hours, means that there is intrauterine pregnancy. And if the serum progesterone level is more than 25 nanogram per milliliter, it also means that there is intrauterine pregnancy, then once again repeat the ultrasonography. But if the transvaginal sonography reveals that in the uterine cavity is empty with the abnormal mass at the fallopian tube, then laparoscopy should be done, that is the examination of the abdominal organs. And if there is unruptured tubal ectopic pregnancy, means the fallopian tubes are not ruptured yet. So in order to treat the unruptured tubal ectopic pregnancy, there are three ways of management, such as expectant management, medical management, and the surgical management. And now I'm going to discuss all these ways of management one by one in detail. If the amount or the level of HCG hormone is falling or decreasing, or if the mass or the ectopic mass diameter is less than 4 cm plus there is no any evidence of bleeding or rupture, then wait for the spontaneous correction or resolution of the tubal pregnancy. Second one is medical management. Under this, there are two ways of administration of drugs in order to correct the tubal pregnancy. First one is direct, means direct administration of drug at the affected site, and second one is systemic. So under direct or local administration, laparoscopy or ultrasonography should be performed side by side in order to guide the location of the tubal pregnancy. So the drugs which are directly administered at the affected site is methotrexate, potassium chloride, prostaglandins, and hyperosmolar glucose. These drugs basically used for salpingocentesis, means the fallopian tubes are punctured in order to directly administer the drug at the affected site. So the first drug is methotrexate. This drug is basically given in the cancer patients, as this is one of the chemotherapeutic drug, but it is found to be very effective in the case of tubal pregnancy also, as it stops the cells from growing. And those cells got absorbed within 4 to 6 weeks. As a result, the level of human chorionic gonadotropin hormone drops. Next is potassium chloride. With the help of this drug, the tubal mass collapsed or shrink slowly and then resolved. Third one is prostaglandin. Specifically, it is known as carboprost. It actually constrict the tubal arteries. As a result, blood supply to the fertilized ovum is stopped and tubal pregnancy is terminated or ended. Next is hyperosmolar glucose. This is mostly given in the case of heterotopic pregnancy. In this case, the two or more pregnancies occurs at the same time, such as one is in intrauterine and the another one is in extrauterine, means outside the uterine cavity. So in this case, the extrauterine gestational sac is removed and the hyperosmolar glucose injection is administered, which as a result protects or preserves the intrauterine gestational sac. On the other hand side, the systemic administration of drugs include methotrexate and actinomycin. The actinomycin also stops the cells from growing. The another way of management of unruptured tubal ectopic pregnancy is surgical management. Under this, again, there are two approaches. First one is extirpative approach. When the organ is damaged, then the complete removal of that organ should be done. So in the case of tubal pregnancy, if the huge damage to the fallopian tube occurs, then salpingectomy should be done. That is, complete removal of fallopian tube should be done. The another approach is conservative approach. In this case, the fallopian tubes are protected. So under conservative approach, again, there are four surgical procedures which can be performed in order to treat the tubal ectopic pregnancy. First one is plucking out from distal tube. Second is salpingostomy. Third one is salpingotomy. And fourth one is segmental resection. Plucking out from distal tube is usually done in the case when the fertilized ovum is implanted at infundibulum part of the fallopian tube. From this, the fertilized ovum or the conceptus is plucked out or removed. Next is salpingostomy. In this, the linear incision or the longitudinal incision is made on the fallopian tube at the site where the fertilized ovum is implanted, and then remove the contents from the fallopian tube. After removing the contents from the fallopian tube, in this case, the incision should be remained open for healing itself without closing it by using any sutures. But in this case, the whole procedure is same as that of salpingostomy, but in this case the incision should be closed by using the sutures. Next is segmental resection. So in this case, the site where the fertilized ovum is implanted should be removed. That part should be removed. And the remaining tube, then the end-to-end anastomosis should be done. Means the remaining two parts of the fallopian tube is then connected. So firstly, cut the section where the fertilized ovum is implanted, and then the remaining portion is joined or connected. That is known as end-to-end anastomosis. At last, follow-up assessment of human chorionic gonadotropin hormone should be done in order to assess any abnormal growth or ectopic pregnancy. That's all about the tubal ectopic pregnancy. I discussed it in detail as it is the one of the common type of ectopic pregnancy, as in the 97% of cases the tubal pregnancy occurs. The other types are actually very uncommon. I hope you all are clear with this topic, but still, my dear students, if you have any kind of query, then please ask me in the comment section. I will definitely answer your queries.